Item seven then is a report entitled Volunteers. And of course it covers special constables as well. Would you like to update on that, please? Thank you.
So, another from me, Commissioner. In terms of the special constabulary, who of course are volunteers, we now have 859 special constables, 360 which are still undergoing training, 499 are fully trained. The report outlines in graphical form that there's been a significant increase in the recruitment, use and deployment of special constables, and as you're aware we've set ourselves an ambition, a target to increase to 1,500 by May 2016. The special constables over the last year have put in 150,000 dedicated hours to police in the communities of West Yorkshire, which I think is commendable for those individuals, and I know you've thanked groups of them individually. We work around independent patrol status and developing them into being full empowered, specific, autonomous police officers. And you can see how their independent patrol status is now at 79%, 80% special constables. In their deployment, you know, they are often involved in supporting district events and operations and specific roads policing initiatives to both support public events and also deal with public requests for assistance of crime and antisocial behaviour. But primarily over the last few years, we've put them towards visibility, engagement, reassurance and the principles of neighbourhood policing. And again, you can see how 78% of their time is on visible patrol. In terms of our recruitment, it is quite simply a matter of there's money we get in and we lose some out, and the majority of those are going on to other employment and primarily within the police family, which is a good thing in terms of developing our workforce, but provides us a challenge to our own target, for want of a better word, of increasing the applications. So we're just below where we would have wanted to be, but in reality, I think by the time we get through, we'll have at least worked through 1,500 people. It's just some of them will have moved on, and I don't want to hit the target without losing sight of actually the objective is about increasing visibility and reassurance and combating crime in the communities, and that's actually what they're doing in those hours already. So there's plenty of statistics in there about some defensiveness about whether they've got to the target or not, but I don't really propose to focus on that really.
Again, it's the issue of it's an ambition, but we need to make sure it's not a perverse incentive. You know, but clearly it certainly helped to focus the drive, shall we say.
I suppose the single line that jumped out on that bit is that you know, we've taken and employed and recruited and trained and developed the equivalent of 6 years worth of normal recruitment in 12 months. So that in its own right is pretty impressive.
Yeah.
And I think for as long as we have got focus and are attracting that age group of 21 to 30 year olds, who are quite frequently students, people who are at the start of their careers, they may move house, their personal circumstances may change, they may become parents, we are inevitably going to have some attrition. Which is a shame, but of course, with a bit of luck, people may choose to return to us once those circumstances have changed again.
In terms of representation, as you're well aware from previous reports, 5% of our police officers from a BME background, 9% of the population, and specials are at 10%. So again, a very good representation of our communities. And we continue with, as you're well aware from previous briefings, and other areas of the specific supporting and targeted briefings and campaigns in each of the districts. To not only encourage all people to join the special constabulary, but again, specifically people from underrepresented groups and those people with protective characteristics, which would encourage to join the service. And again, I think the statistics underlie actually the openness and the ability to join the police service through that avenue in West Yorkshire, I think is very commendable. That's special constables, and I'll forward there if there's anything on that. It's
yeah, so if we just take a few questions then on the specials situation as set out in the report again, which is overall very positive. So again, I appreciate the huge amount of work that's going in around the training and recruitment. However, there are some questions really that arise from the numbers that we are getting in, and certainly I've asked probably one of the questions before, but it's worth revisiting, and it's around independent patrol status, where we have clearly a situation where it's 12 months. The national guidelines are 12 months around achieving independent patrol status, but still currently in West Yorkshire it's 24 months, and I just thought, given the numbers we are now getting in and the potential use of specials themselves around mentoring and tutoring, whether that is being looked at again.
Yeah, I mean, the Specials and Volunteers Board, again, regularly reviews it. As we previously said, we considered to take a more conservative, cautious approach to it, in that it's, you know, a minimum requirement of 16 hours a month, and to actually have an individual with all the powers of a police officer, on independent patrol is a big ask for the individual, as well as for the organisation who's, you know, responsible for that person and the service they deliver. The majority of special constables' hours are often in the evenings and at weekends, which is during our primary double crewing period anyway, and so it actually doesn't cause us any operational issues in terms of having them double crewed and them agreeing in their accreditation and sort of probationary period. We've tried as much to mirror the student officer probationary period. So in terms of a full-time regular officer of 40 hours a week, it's 2 years. And so actually we just feel a little bit apprehensive around a part-time 16 hours a month officer at being 12 months. But as and when, if it causes operational deployment issues, I think we'd revisit it again. Mm-hmm. But we're totally with you on the idea of independent patrol status for more visibility and engagement with the public.
We would like to get as many people through as swiftly as possible, but again, you mentioned perverse incentives. We don't want individuals feeling under pressure to try and complete that work and work excessive hours with us in order to get that status, particularly if they're already in full-time employment. And secondly, John's quite right to sort of flag up that we want to make sure that they have and are tutored by the very best quality officers that we can, and we want to make sure that they're available at the times when those special constables come on duty. So we took the decision pragmatically to make sure that we didn't lose people towards the end of that first year who felt that there was no opportunity to successfully complete that independent patrol status within the 12-month period. It might take them a little bit longer, and we actually thought that that was quite a pragmatic and sensible thing to do, when, as John's quite rightly said, you look at the student officer requirement, who actually has 2 years, accepting that they have additional roles, additional responsibilities, but actually if we are truly one great big huge policing family, then there ought to be some parity between the processes as far as we're concerned.
Yeah, well perhaps the question then is the 12 month the national guidance, is that realistic in light of, you know, your experience locally?
And again, it depends on what the arrangements are that you have in force in terms of recruitment, and actually enabling people to reach the required competency levels. Some forces have built upon their previous probation development units, for example, and make use of tutors that way. I just think that when the discussion was taking place, when the national strategy was set, then clearly there was an aspiration to try and encourage people to go through that process as swiftly as possible, but accepting that some forces would find that quite challenging.
A question then that arises on the back of that. So if we know that the limited number of full-time police officers that we are recruiting are from the special constabulary, and if they've already served 2 years or more within as a special, do I take it then that if they are successful in being recruited as a full-time officer, they will be eligible as a independent patrol status? Yeah. With if we'd already achieved that as a special.
We tried to recruit the specials, those recruits from the internal campaign. We tried to have courses of specials and courses of other police staff, and they compressed even further their developmental training, because to stop the duplication. Yeah. They don't come out of it ironically with full independent patrol status, because there's a slight difference in terms of independent patrol for a neighbourhood response constable involving driving a vehicle to incidents and to jobs where they're more than likely going to be encountering arrest situations and confrontation is slightly different to the independent patrol status of a special constable who doesn't respond to jobs in the same manner, if that makes sense.
But surely it should have an impact on the length of time.
Absolutely, yes. It's got the potential for them to complete those competencies.
They don't do the full
quicker.
2 years in the sense of you can become independent, signed off as a student officer, as all get doing in less than 2 years. But so it compresses quickly because they're rare experience. We put less training and investment in the training into them because we've already given them it, and then they deal with their development a lot quicker to become independent as a substantive constable, full-time constable, as opposed to a special constable.
Yeah.
And if you look at, for example, the recent award ceremony, the Officer of the Year was a former special constable. We get fantastic feedback, in fact, from those individuals who've already got some of that experience under their belt. Which is why, as you know, I've been very keen to continue for that to be the main source of recruits at this moment in time. Yeah. And actually, I think it's a success story to say that 36% of the specials that we've been talking about who've lasted in the 12 months have actually joined the organisation full time, so retain their skills.
Yeah. No, I'm absolutely convinced it's the right policy. Again, just coming back to the issue, that given that we're getting the highest number of specials we've ever had in West Yorkshire, it's about how we use the specials with more experience in terms of the supervision and the tutoring, and how we're developing a sort of a programme around that to do that
past. You know, there's sort of elements of leadership within the Special Constabulary itself, which is a subject of national debate in its own right, and we are increasingly using them for development and peer support of their colleagues. And whether that's to gain independent patrol status or not. And we're also increasingly using specials for specific skill bases, whether it's around CSE or cybercrime, and training them up for specific investigative processes to provide additional resilience in the safeguarding arena as well, which has been really good.
And certainly there is a real appetite for looking at what specials we could have moving forwards. So Protective Services Ops are already looking at further enhancements with the small number that they currently have. And I know Mark Milson would be more than happy if he could encourage even more people to want to come and join us to actually have people working within that arena, for example.
Yeah, well, just touching on that, so on the table where it says duties undertaken, for the period March 14 to May 14, and then March 15 to May 15. The biggest sort of thing that stands out there is the reduction in naval policing duties. And then the corresponding, well, more than increase in the response aspect, and to a lesser extent, district stroke operations. And it's really just a question around, does that balance seem quite right given the numbers we're getting in?
The national strategy up to 2014 was really encouraging all forces to place their special constables into neighbourhood policing. That had two impacts. The first is a significant number of specials chose to leave because actually they wanted to support the response policing aspect of police work, and it probably suited their hours, and actually more often than not that was also supporting sort of city centre type work, even at nighttime economy work. And that had the effect then of skewing where you were seeing specials doing their hours. What we're now trying to do in the first place is to welcome everybody who wants to come and do this kind of voluntary work, and then try and match their requirements with ours. Some officers very, very happy doing neighbourhood policing work, as you're aware. Others, perhaps those who do have aspirations to join the job, knowing that they are more likely to go on to response when they are posted, if they're successful, are probably being a little bit more attracted to that area of work. It's something that, as you know, we have a goal group that looks at volunteers and specials. We'll continue to monitor. But actually, rather than trying to force people into a particular area or a particular type of duty, what we're trying to do is encourage people to actually split and share their duties and do some of some of another.
Yeah, no, I don't understand that. It's just that, I mean, you know, obviously there are pressures in all departments and areas of work, but it was just really that sort of strategic vision really around the visibility aspect of neighbourhood policing, and of course the fact that we are unfortunately losing some of our officers and PCSOs as a result of the government cuts to our budgets. So it's just really strategically whether there's a bit more thinking about trying to deploy.
I think the, the commanders, if they were in the room, has probably said it's a needs must over the last year, and they're probably coming with the intention of going on neighbourhood patrol. They've been deployed into more traditional response capability, which is still within the neighbourhoods.
But equally, there's something for me about having that reserve that are happy and comfortable about doing response, which means they would turn out to help support that team, particularly if for whatever reason there were abstractions on that team, and then we didn't need to rely upon neighbourhood policing actually fulfilling that backfill. The specials would be more than able to do that. So there is a balancing act to be had here, I think.
Okay. Right, thank you.
In terms of volunteers, I still consider it to be a good story, Commissioner, but the scale of the volunteer numbers is maybe not comparable to the special constables. At the moment, the police report, we've got 570 volunteers within the organisation. That's 233 police service volunteers, 165 community volunteers. We have 150 explorers currently, which is our under 18 volunteer programme, and 20 new student guardians. And that also goes alongside a traditional volunteer group of community members assisting the police of 3,340 neighbourhood watch coordinators, who mustn't lose sight of providing their own time in a voluntary capacity to benefit their own communities. So again, as you're aware, we've set an ambition, a desire to go towards 1,000 volunteers by 2016. The rise in statistics in frank terms probably indicates that we're not going to get to that if we continue where we are, but we're continuing with the increased recruitment. So those volunteers amongst them have done around the best part of 30,000 hours of work with policing over the last year. And the majority of them, you know, have come in either on a variety of methods, either weekly or sometimes monthly. In terms of the breakdown, we don't have a definitive breakdown of ethnicity and background, because we don't ask the questions on the front end, just to do with the systems, and Hillary's team are looking at that in terms of our statistical analysis of that. You can see on the page there with the graph that it's a 636 total against a target of 799. Again, we have a turnover of people who come into the organisation, and most of them going off either for personal reasons or other employment reasons or domestic reasons as to why they can no longer give time. So the districts and departments continue to seek recruitment in a variety of different ways, we've gone down a more specific targeted recruitment of we wish you to do this role, rather than going back to where we first started with trying to get anybody and then not being able to find them a job to do, because clearly that didn't work particularly well for us. So we do have a variety of, whether it's callbacks, antisocial behaviour, domestic abuse support, or to Cargate, stable hands and helps with visitors, or more into the community engagement of leafleting and handing out information, or to the community safety of students and student guardians, and working alongside the Angel programmes and other areas. So we're again at the Special Constables and Volunteering Board is looking at the recruitment and the training and the vetting and the development of volunteers. But whilst it's not on the trajectory to meet the ambition, I still think we're in a good place, and the overall increase has increased our capacity and our support to communities.
Right, yes, thank you. I think you've touched on some of the things I was probably considering asking about, so it's really probably a bit more explanation around the different types of volunteer jobs that people do, I think would be helpful. And it might help in the sort of recruitment aspect of it as well. Is there any particular reasons why it appears 155 community volunteers have left in the last 3 months? I know you touched on some of the possible reasons.
I think we've had a review of who's doing what and who's providing what hours, and a pragmatic approach to say that you may be on our books, are you still able and willing to come forward and help us, and if not, let's just call it a draw, which we could have quite easily carried on with those, but we need people who are active. So in the same way, that if the same principles have been applied to the Special Constabulary, but not as rigidly. So if you recall, we did the same 2 years ago with specials, but if you're not doing your hours, well, you know, need to be committed to this or not. The same with this, that we've politely parted way if people are no longer able to commit to it.
Okay. And similarly then on the, we've mentioned the 3,340 Neighbourhood Watch coordinators, how confident are we that they are all relatively active or in regular engagement with the police?
We use the Neighbourhood Watch coordinator role and the coordinators quite actively, and it's just through the use of email we're then able to see whether people are working well. I think you've hit on a point about what else we could do with them and how we could extend their role. But it's something that's been taken by the command team to the board again to say, right, are we going to bring them into this volunteer programme and include them and train them and develop them as volunteers rather than just fulfilling that single strand role?
It's a question I've posed to Chris Joyce, and we're looking at pulling together some footage specifically aimed to our Neighbourhood Watch people, not only a message of support and thank you very much, but actually what else could we do moving forwards.
Yeah, well, we have one of their annual meetings coming up, Sharon, don't we, at the,
at
Cargate.
It's the West Yorkshire Police.
Yes, So, bearing in mind, despite the questions, we need to remember that they are all volunteers, both special constables and volunteers, and, I certainly take my hat off to them, as I'm sure you and the members of the public do as well, so we just need to bear that in mind. There are a number of other more detailed questions on the back of this report, but I think there are ones that can be taken in slower time. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.